One, I have a case to do, so I should get moving. I may have to leave a little early. Hopefully, the anesthesia will go slowly. Dr. D'Amico is actually opening for me this morning, so I can be here. We're going to flip-flop. Originally, I was going to go at 10. We had a late start date today, on short notice, which means the OR sometimes starts once a week. The OR starts late, so people can have conferences and meetings. And we moved that from Monday to Tuesday this last month, and I just forgot that it was changed. So it's a late start day on Tuesday now. So this would have overlapped with this talk. I just want to introduce, I know Greg talked to you all last week. Greg is my closest friend and now my business partner as well. And what we're going to talk about is, obviously you're all interested in medicine and in healthcare or healthcare ideas. And the next thing that I'm trying to talk the most about is leadership. And I'm going to talk about my trajectory into entrepreneurship. And I think Greg came from a different trajectory from Wall Street. I'm sure in all your worlds that, you have friends, family, choosing to go into medicine, into healthcare, you're giving up certain activities that might be maybe seem more straightforward, make more money earlier, whatever that means. And give you an opportunity not have to go through a residency and the struggles. But I personally believe there's nothing else you can do better with your life than being a physician. And it's not easy all the time. It actually sucks sometimes. But all in all, I wouldn't really rather be doing anything else. I think Greg has a perspective as well. Greg has three young kids. His oldest, Ian, is applying to med school this year. His middle son is may or may not. He's an engineer, and his youngest is likely going to be a social worker or involved with taking care of people. And that I think is a reflection of the emphasis Greg's put in his family on taking care of people. So with that, why don't we just get started? I'll share my screen as we like to do. So I think I'll lead off and Greg and I'll bounce this off one another. This is really a talk about being creative and about finding a vision and sticking to it. And the benefits of that as a doctor. The healthcare is a very complex world, and especially as you get older, I think some of the things that you did early on, it doesn't mean they're not that they're boring, but if you want to be a leader, you want to turn that over to people who, most operations, I'd say 80% of operations in neurosurgery, just one of my young guys or a talented young neurosurgeon can do as well as I can. There are definitely operations that require more investment and more time. But over time, in order to develop a larger influence, you begin to pull back from some of the more straightforward things. And in doing so, your brain can open up to other ideas. Greg put the slide together about playback. Whether it's what's your playback? What's going to be your thing that's going to give you that extra thing? And it doesn't mean you have to think about this now, but there are opportunities every day. And it just means finding that thing that really you like to do, that you want, that can match with your healthcare interest or not. I mean, somebody might want to be learn about cooking or making movies or painting or art, or one of my partners, Mitch Levine, makes olive oil, and in Italy, and is basically a Renaissance art expert. Well, that's not my thing. I always was an Apple guy and was always into technology and. Healthcare is moving into this new age. When I first started this project in 2006, 2007, no one even considered these kinds of things. Partly, we didn't have mobile devices like this. There was no iPad. There was no cloud. There was no patient experience as a focus of doctors. I think this little picture up top says it all. If you watch the Netflix show, is this a movie, Greg, or is this a still?
That's a picture. The film is, I can show the film later.
Yeah,
Like.
that's us using, taking a full circle, that's just using the technology that we developed during COVID. And I think that to me was a major accomplishment. A lot of that had to do with Greg. But before I turn it back over to Greg, I'm going to show you guys a little movie clip from a movie called 50-50. It was back around 2015 or so, or 2017, I think. And just watch the show, watch the movie, and then we'll talk about it. Oops. Uh-oh. The clip not come through. There we go. Hi.
Patient has been complaining of back pain and night sweats. Blood tests and urine analysis are normal. MRI suggests a massive intradural malignant schwannoma neurofibrosarcoma extending into psoas muscle with nerve root compression syndrome and bone erosion. Growth extends from L2 to L5. We'll send the patient for biopsy to confirm. Yes, question.
Sorry, I didn't follow that. Is there something wrong with me?
Yes. Well, if you look here on your MRI, you see this cephalopod-like object that's spreading down your spinal column. That is a massive schwannoma neurofibrosarcoma.
Okay. So sorry, I just don't know what
it's a malignant tumor.
A tumor?
Yes.
Me?
Yes.
that doesn't make any sense, though. I mean, I don't smoke, I don't drink, I recycle.
Actually, your case is really quite fascinating because your cancer is the result of an incredibly rare gene mutation in chromosome 7 through the MP53 gene. I think that given the placement and size of your particular tumor, the wisest course of action is to see if we can possibly reduce this thing down to a more manageable size before we consider surgery. Now, chemotherapy can often result in fertility issues.
But I'm going to be okay.
If you need someone to talk to, we have an excellent staff here at the hospital of social workers and psychologists. They specialize in these matters, and they would be able to help you. Now, as I said, you should consider...
So, before we go to the next slide, I can turn, when Greg's going to go a little bit over the idea, if you go back to that movie, a couple things happen. First, the patient comes into, that's Michael Joel Levitt, who's terrific. I think that's what his name is. Is that right? I'm pretty sure that's right. The patient comes into the office. He opens up a pamphlet. That actual pamphlet says living with incontinence. So right off the bat, I think that's a metaphor for just how patients get their information. They're basically on the internet now, or they're grabbing a pamphlet. It has nothing to do with them. It's often for all patients with a problem. And so their information sources can be faulty. The next thing is you have a physician using a pen, which he's probably got from, may have gotten from a drug company, pointing at a computer screen at an MRI scan. Well, first of all, he's using a $10 pen to describe what really is a $1 trillion technology. If you think about MRI, the amazing thing about MRI, you're basically taking a magnet and you're getting images inside the body. It's science fiction. And the billions of dollars and now trillions of dollars that have come out of that, the diagnoses and the surgeries that have all been developed because of MRI. But really all the money's been just to get patients into the hospital without thinking about, well, how are we going to get them the information that they need to understand their problem, get them out of the hospital? Because hospitals get paid and doctors get paid for operating. They're not getting paid to educate. They're not historically and not getting paid to get people out of the hospital. And so there wasn't really any money being spent on transmitting that information. That being said, what's the best way to do that? And I think, Greg, why don't you describe your epiphany, and then we'll talk about how, coming up with an idea, it just has to be what the idea was and how that can be, it's an entrepreneurial concept. And why don't you can describe what you went through.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. Yeah, as Dave mentioned, I kind of knew what he was doing for quite a few years, this idea of using video to better communicate with patients. And I guess my aha moment was, when I had an accident on a bike, and I woke up on an ambulance and on my way to the hospital. And after a lot of drugs and about probably, I don't know, a couple of hours, a few hours in the hospital, they sent me home with a stack of papers. And, you know, the next day I got a hold of the surgeon and he said, well, you'll have your do you have your x-rays with you? And I didn't have any x-rays. I had to drive back to the hospital, get that little CD-ROM that we often see of my x-rays. And I showed up at the surgeon's place and he said, can I see your discharge papers? The nurse is going to need those in order to give your diagnosis. I had to drive back to the hospital and get a second stack of papers because I left my my first one in the cab home from the hospital. And so I finally showed up. I had all of my stuff. And the only way that I could actually see my x-rays was to take a picture of the doctor's computer screen when he wasn't looking. It felt like I was doing something I wasn't supposed to do by sneaking a picture so I could see what my x-rays looked like. And for me, this was just kind of the idea that, look, medical information shouldn't be this hard to understand your diagnosis and treatment, to get your own records. And this was my epiphany, like, oh, okay, I get it. You know, having video sent, right, a film review sent to your phone so that you can better understand your care. So for me, it was a pretty obvious solution.
So in the end, I think that, you know, the idea of transferring information to patients is a simple one. The trouble is are the technologies that exist in healthcare, primarily electronic medical record, the spoken word, or reports and things that you just hand to patients. Patients can come to my office and they're like, I'm like, what's your problem? They go, I have a herniated disc at L3-4, L4-5, and L5-S1. No, what's your problem? Like, what are you complaining of? Because patients now, they go in their portals, they get the report, they read it, and they come to you with some of its real knowledge and other of its feigned. You know, they can go on the internet and look up, you know, lumbar disc or cerebral aneurysm or Moyamoy disease, and they come in with a superficial level of knowledge, and that's to their credit. But by the same token, it's our responsibility to educate them specifically to their specific and unique problem. So I kind of like got this idea way back, you know, now 13 years ago, to record things, to basically, why not create movies of the computer screen of me going over your problem, your MRI, your CAT scan, record it and create a deliverable for patients. And ultimately, not every, you know, entrepreneurship is anybody can do it. The key thing is identifying a simple problem and trying to solve it. There are many, many simple problems in hospitals and in healthcare. The trouble is, sometimes they seem insurmountable because of conventional wisdom and because of legacy and the things that really prevent innovation. But to really innovate and to be entrepreneurial, you have to overcome some of those things. And some of that just means you have to have, you know, in Greg's words, grit, you know, and determination and focus. And, you know, I think Greg left his job as a head in a hedge fund world and then moved into this a time for a few months where he wasn't, he was looking to see what his next part of his life was. And then he made some decisions. So Greg, why don't you talk about, you know, what it was like to, first of all, decide to leave your, you know, world that you were certainly did well in, but there were things that were missing, obviously, you know, what some of those things were. If you had done it again, what are the kind of the things you'd look for differently in a job or in a career that you may, and, you know, obviously this was something that really attracted you when these kids age, what changed in you over time? And then what led you to the idea of becoming an entrepreneur?
Yeah, thanks, Dave. So some of this touches upon the concept that we talked about last week about your flywheel. But I think in my case, you know, I was a biomedical engineer pre-med, just like my son, interestingly. He's going to go on to med school. And I decided that I wanted to go to New York City after being offered a biomedical engineering job. So, you know, back in 86, when I got out of school, it was biomedical engineering was a very different field than it is today and offered different opportunities. But for me, just getting out of college, I had an opportunity to go to New York City. And so I was like, I'd love to go to the city. And that was kind of my first stepping off point to not what you do, but, you know, kind of following, you know, some gut feeling that maybe something was out there. And I ended up actually programming for my first year when I got to New York. It had nothing to do with my education. I think I took a couple of programming classes for my biomedical engineering. But you know, I took the MCATs, I took all of that stuff, and then I went off and programmed in the city. And I quickly fell in love with New York City. I ended up switching into investment banking, and then I went back and got a business school degree, and went back into trading, where I spent the next 25 years trading. And I loved it. I really did. It was what I did. I loved what I did. I loved the people that I was working with. It was a very athletic environment. It was a very results oriented. You know, I knew every day at the end of the day, whether we won or lost. And for me, that was, you know, that at the time it was something that I really relished in, and I loved it. But I think over time you start to realize, like, you know, these, you have to have these passions that are enduring. And these are one of the things that the flywheel concepts talk about is, you know, you want to be able to have passion. You have to have, you have to be of service. This is the other thing that we talked about. And I think, you know, I certainly had passion. I had great people. It was a super lot of fun. I was doing it in New York City. I loved it. But, you know, the two things that were missing for me ultimately was being of service. And I think as I got older and as I watched my kids grow up and telling them, I don't care what you do, just have passion, surround yourself with people that you love, and get after it. And after a while, I realized that, you know, a lot of the passion that that I started in New York and started to be in finance and follow these types of things, that started to fall off. And a lot of it had to do with the fact that I was focusing on the what and not the who. So we talked about this last time, focus less on the what and more on the who you surround yourself with, who are your inspiration, who are the people that you love and respect. So when I left finance, the one thing I did know is that whatever I did do, it was going to be with people I love and respect. And so it was really interesting to think about, you know, what David was doing and what I was trying to accomplish. And so I started hanging out with Dave and at Lennox and going to some of these, I think the first thing we did, Dave, was that there was a Shark Tank-esque like thing that you all did where you brought in a bunch of young people that were trying to do some really neat things in healthcare. I actually invested in one of those companies as a result of that. But after being in there and being re-inspired around really super smart people that were doing things and were of service, I really got hooked into it. So, you know, my hook was back in the finance of investing in something, investing time, investing money, and investing in people. And soon I started to kind of live around Dave's world, which for me was fascinating. Like, you know, the stuff that Dave does, I was always in awe of it. Dave brought me down to one of the surgeries. And I remember sitting in there in the operating room, like, who does this? Someone's getting brain surgery. And I'm sitting in the operating room watching this. And it really hit me upside the head about what it means to be of service for others and the opportunity. Plus, it's just absolutely fascinating what they all were doing. And so when I saw Dave struggling to stand up a company outside of Northwell to do this idea of better communication and collaboration around instances of care using video and the computer in your pocket, I thought it was a great idea. He was super passionate about it. And for me, it was a great step off to follow something that I was passionate about, that was about the people I was doing it with. It was being of service, you know, just ticked off all of the things that I was thinking about my next phase of life. But I think the thing that really hooked me was just being around that environment of super smart people and, you know, living off that sense of service and purpose. It's really addicting, and it was great. I mean, I applaud everybody that's here that's thinking about a career in medicine, because it ain't easy. Nobody does it because it's easy. You do it because it's hard, but you do it because it gives you a fulfillment, a happiness, an experience that you cannot get anywhere else. And that's why I thought your what you sent, I don't know if you sent it last night, Dave, or this morning, this idea of experience over appearance really resonates in a lot of different ways. It's not just about your career, but it's the people you're with. It's what you do for fun. It's what you do for work. it really shouldn't, you know, this idea of play and work and separate categories, it's really all about life, and it's about an experience, and it's about where you put yourself, who you put yourself with, and then the determination and passion to see it through. And that, those are kind of the you know, what got me here to where I was doing. But there was a lot of people that told David and I, like, look, it's a bad idea to go into business with your friends. And my attitude was like, look, if I can't do this with my friends and I can't be successful with Dave in this environment, you know, maybe I'm not a good friend, or maybe Dave's not a good friend, because that should not be the problem. And I think that was kind of the kind of the basics for what we decided when we decided to do it, is that we knew what we knew. We knew what we didn't know, and we knew what the other person knew. It was a great fit for us. And we were just very honest, very transparent about it. But at the end of the day, the thing that mattered is both of us approached every day with grit. Every day we got up and started to take swings. And when you do that with other people who are, everybody's pulling in the boat, and I know David would love this analogy because it's what he spent so much of his life doing. But when everyone grabs an oar and goes, nothing better. And when you're doing it with people you love and experiences that you can share, it's what it's all about.
I mean, I think one of the things you all have to start thinking about is the relationships you have right now last a lifetime. You start finding those people in your life that you trust. And, you know, I was going to tell the same story, how, you know, the last thing you most businesses do is do it with a friend, because, oh God, you might not agree, or there might be a money issue. But I knew myself that my interests are about the experience and the outcome rather than transactional, you know, some sort of transactional thing. And so when you have to know yourself first, that requires a tremendous amount of self-awareness. If you're someone who's more selfish, you know, if you don't have that in you innately, it doesn't mean you can't be successful. You have to sort of know that. And then you may have a harder time with some of these decisions. It doesn't mean, but you have to be very transparent about that. I'm not like that, you know. If anything, I give up a little too much, and I, you know, have a hard time with boundaries because I just trust people. But I knew Greg well enough to know that this is the biggest decision potentially of my life. If this really was going to go somewhere, this is something I've been working on for a long time. If you're going to turn it over to someone, you know, you better know them pretty well and know what your own investment is, but not just financially, but emotionally. I think that just choosing those things is becoming so important. I think I agree with Greg. You know, your career is your life. It's, you know, we all talk about jobs and retirement. I mean, these retirement commercials drive me crazy, because, you know, if you start your work and all you're worried about is retiring, you know, you might as well just quit. I mean, and I tell my kids, you know, you don't want to be in a cubicle. Going back to my rowing days, when I was basically in a camp trying out for the national crew team, and when I was in college, and it was during the summer, and I was working. I was trying to make some money because we would have two a day. So we'd row in the morning at 6. It was beautiful, like beautiful time in the summer, really hot, shirt off, just crushing it in the water. And we'd come home, but then I went to work to try to make some cash because I couldn't just sit around all day because we had another practice at 4 or 5 in the afternoon. And I was working one of my dad's friends had a computer company back then. Crazy. He was one of the original that these made these cards that you'd feed these data cards into these giant computers. And I was helping organize the output. And I remember sitting in this office in a cubicle, like this thing on the sides. And I was constantly looking at the clock. And I couldn't wait to go get a cup of coffee. Like at around 10 o'clock, I started drinking coffee, walk over, get a coffee. And then it was lunchtime. And then lunchtime would come, and I'd, thank God, I had lunch for an hour. Then I'd go sit back in that freaking desk for 2 hours. Then I would leave to go row. And I was like, I can't imagine doing this for the rest of my life. And, you know, in order to do something that's really substantive and valuable, it takes, you know, it takes work. And it's easy to go into a cubicle and just do your job, get paid, and go home. But it's harder sometimes to take some risk, especially in Greg's case, leaving something he was with a certain amount of familiarity and really change his life. You know, let me go back to the talk now. We can go a little bit more into, you know, atmospherics with playback. You know, I think that Greg showed you the slide before about forgetting. And this is the reason why memorializing information is so important. You know, if we can chat with someone, we can create a text or an audio file or a video, or, you know, asynchronous communication, meaning making something for the patient, about the patient, asynchronously, that they can carry with them to their other doctors, really, really valuable. And so that was the essential, you know, thesis behind playback. Going back to that movie, you know, this happens. People don't forget what they're told. They tune out. You know, their minds, when you're telling them medical information, they don't have they're attacking emotionally, not intellectually, especially at the beginning. And so giving them some information that's fixed, it can be really valuable. And that was really the initial idea. That's why, as crazy as that, you know, 2020 movie is, it's not that far off from reality. The EMR, which is what, why isn't this working? The EMR, which is really designed for the purposes of putting the information and making it available digitally, really interferes with us. It's one of the biggest frustrations of physicians, actually. And so playback is an attempt to basically take out from the EMR what's important and create a deliverable for the patient. You know, the EMR, the concept of EMR and what's called HIPAA. HIPAA is the patient protection rules of health information, along with the EMR itself. It all sort of grew out of the same issues, is that when things were documents and not digital, they were hard to get access to, they were hard to share, they were hard to lock down and protect. And, you know, HIPAA itself grew out of the AIDS epidemic. Well, when back in the mid 90s, if you had AIDS, you either gay or Haitian. And back then, if you were gay, people discriminated against you if you were gay. You know, if people who are homosexual, men mostly who had AIDS, they didn't want people to know that they were gay. And they certainly didn't want them to know they were HIV positive, because it could affect your ability to get insurance, get a job. And so this connectivity between a real medical issue and a social determinant of care, which was being a homosexual at the time, was one of the things that drove patient privacy. And it drove patient privacy because you had a large group of vocal people who are concerned about their livelihood, their life, their lifestyle, and their ability to live a life of meaning, because someone would find out that they were about their sexual preference or about their medical history. And ultimately, that's really what drove HIPAA. HIPAA created patient protection. The EMR and ultimately the Accountable Care Act created the current EMRs, which ultimately grew out of scheduling and billing software. And that's part of the problem. And what they had good intent. The original designs were just to take all the patient information, put it somewhere, and have it accessible, but also accessible securely, promote privacy, but it also gave the insurers and the hospital tremendous data, that it gave them an understanding of what was going on, and they could. Data is king, as we've all learned. So, but it did ultimately interfere with patient care, and it really, really, really hurt us. It hurt our profession, I think. The other thing that became more important as time went on was things like patient experience. This is a readmission chart showing that the hospitals became more and more driven by some metrics related to their financial situations that were due to what's called readmission rates or patient experience, and so. As the EMRs really diminished our ability to be happy as doctors, hospitals developed new metrics to make money. And so these two things started to converge. And it's that convergence of the failure of the EMR and the failure of information, of easy access to information that was accurate and patient-specific, along with new hospital concepts of the importance of patient experience, the importance of patient understanding their medical problem at discharge, understanding their overall medical issues to make good decisions, that suddenly became important. And Greg found this article that basically when patients are happy, they do better. Then not only do they are less likely to be readmitted, they don't sue as often, their outcomes are better. So we started to connect some dots here between what really makes sense, and we all think of as being a good physician, and a financial incentive, because without financial incentive, things fail. And I think that ultimately, and Greg, you can comment on this, you can be the most liberal, you know, ethical, non-money driven person in the world. But ultimately, no matter what your idea is, if it doesn't make money, if it can't support itself, it will fail. That doesn't mean that money should be your North Star. It just means that money has to be, this my project vacillated and it struggled for years. Not only because we didn't have money and we didn't have leadership. We didn't have somebody who understood the mechanical ways of creating value. And so you can't diminish the importance of money. Money is an important a measure of success in some ways, but more importantly, it's a measure of health, of being able to continue to do things. Hospitals have to make money, doctors have to make money. We all do. It just depends on where it is on your list of importance. Money to me is an expression of that something was successful, not that I'm successful because I make money. It's a subtle difference. And I think even Elon Musk, who, you know, if you read about him, who may end up being maybe one of the most successful entrepreneurs of our generation, you know, ultimately, he's not about money. Here's a guy that made $500 million from PayPal, and he put it all back into Tesla and SpaceX. He was willing to throw it all away. Because if you believe in something and it works, the money takes care of itself. And I don't know if you want to contrast, Greg, your vision on this when you were in Wall Street. You mentioned, you know, you would know whether you won or lost every day because that your measure was how much money you made. But how has your brain changed as you become more entrepreneurial, as you've, taken on this project? Have you noticed in yourself a difference in the way you gauge your own success? Do you talk differently about it? Do you think differently about it?
Oh gosh. Yeah. Well, actually, Dave, can you just unshare your screen for a second? I just wanted to pull something up just to give a little structure to that comment. So what I wanted to do, I know some of you already heard this. Everybody can see my screen, I assume. I know we talked a little bit about this, but this is kind of a good point to just talk about like what's important for great ideas and great concepts. I think for me, I'm beating this like a dead horse, but you know, this idea of surrounding yourself with people who not only you love and respect, but who are inherently optimistic and who drive themselves to be better every day. It's contagious. You know, I always tell my kids, you're the average of your five closest friends, right? It's kind of a goofy little saying, but it has a lot of meaning. And in the people you surround yourself, you start to adapt characteristics of, you know, their demeanor, their work ethic, their, shared ideas. It doesn't mean you have to adopt them or mimic them. And in fact, I would say don't, because that's not what you're trying to get to, but learn from other people and apply it to yourself. But when you take a step back and talk about great companies and what drives a great company, you know, it's back to this idea of the flywheel framework that Jim Collins put together. But the things that he measured with great companies are superior results, whatever they might be, defining what those superior results are, a distinctive impact. And this is what David's point is if you have a great company that's doing great things and you stop doing those things, would people miss it, right? And it's kind of an interesting concept. Like, people start to take on certain dependencies of the things around them such that the great companies that supply those things for people, if you took it away, would they feel it? And then this idea of lasting endurance. And lasting endurance is affected by a lot of different things. It's not only a great product, but you have to continually innovate with that product and continually make it topical and useful, and it changes. You look like a company like GE, for example. It's a 100-year-old company that over the last, really ever since 2008, when the crisis hit, it had to continue to innovate or die. And it slowly dying. I haven't looked at where the stock is lately, but it's a company that when you think about it, everybody loved GE and what it was doing. But if you don't continually innovate and continue to be have a distinctive impact with a lasting endurance, you fade. And the inputs for that, which is really what David and I have focused on, are the people, the thought, the action that's applied every single day to turn your flywheel to make sure that you hit those outputs. And it's the people that you hire to make sure that they're disciplined in the way that they get up every day, get in the batter's box and take swings at the ball. It's something that you have to do every day. You have to be thoughtful about what it is that you want to accomplish that day. And it's this idea of disciplined thought and disciplined action every single day that has a compounding effect of a series of good decisions over a long period of time, which gets you to where you want to be, which gets you to accomplish these outputs, so that when you look back 6 months, a year, 5 years, 10 years, you will be amazed at what's been accomplished because you've been disciplined every day and done a little bit every day. And I think about this in a lot of different things, whether your career is focused on the mental aspects of achievement or the physical aspects of achievement. And I know David could speak to this as well, but the idea that if you want to be a great rower, or you want to be a great cyclist, or you want to be a great tennis player, a golfer, anything, you have to work at it every single day, which means if you want to be a good cyclist, you have to get up every day and cycle every day. And it's not about, you're not going to crush it your first day. You're going to do a little bit Monday, Tuesday, maybe some interval training in a little bit. And then on the weekends, you go out and you repeat it. And after a few weeks, a few months, you start to get better. After a year, you know, you accomplish some really great things just because you got up every day, focused on what your outputs, what your passions are, who the people that you're doing it with. But you have to make sure that you apply that grit so that you get in the batter's box every day and achieve. And those are the things that make great people and great companies. It's a discipline action every single day that has a compounding effect that over a long period of time, you accomplish great things. But to David's point, it requires that what your outputs, what you're going after has a lasting endurance. Because if you don't have that lasting endurance, then you're not going to be able to focus that on and be successful over the long haul.
So I'll pick up from there, Greg. I'm going to spend another about 15 minutes. Randy's in my room setting my case up. So he has a 10 o'clock. So I'll probably leave you a little early to answer questions, if that's okay. And I'll just finish with a couple different metaphoric things. I showed this video before another talk, but I'm going to use it differently today. Greg loves this. This is one of Greg's favorite things. So this is going back to the athletic metaphor. This is going to happen in your life. Something like this will happen. I guarantee it. There will be change, whether it's COVID in a big level or a new technology that just shows up in your hospital or in your practice, or even a new, if you're an administrator, maybe a new administrative tool, or if you're a nurse, maybe a, you know, new patient problem. This will happen. Something's going to change in your life, and probably it'll start happening today. This is a video of the high jump of the 1968 Olympics in Mexico City. And this guy, who was not the best high jumper actually, but you look at this high jump, it looks like every other high jump. And you look at that thing he landed on, it looks like every other high jump that you're aware of. Well, this wasn't every other high jumper, because he was the first high jumper ever in the Olympic history to go over the bar backwards. And his name was Dick Fosbury. Now, Dick was not a superstar athlete. He was very tall. He was obviously athletic, but he never would have been a world champion and a gold medalist had he jumped the old-fashioned way. He developed this Fosbury flop, which is going over the bar with your head first, over on your back. The reason why that actually works is the center of gravity is raised in the old days, they used to do a scissor step over it or try to like literally jump over the bar. And the trouble with that is you could, your center of gravity was much lower, it was really around your waist. And to you, that's the high, that you couldn't get your waist up high enough. That wherever the center of gravity is, the highest it's gonna go. Well, by making the center of gravity your chest and getting it much higher, you're able to get over the bar much, in a much higher bar. And every high jumper jumps like this. Well, the genius of Fosbury might've been the technique of getting over the bar. But does anybody out there know what the actual reason why he came up with this was? It wasn't, oh, I'm gonna jump over with my head first. Had nothing to do with it. In fact, what led to this was 4 or 5 years before, in the early 60s, when high jumping, you know, was been around for a long time, and high jumpers used to develop a lot of knee and ankle problems because they weren't landing on a cushion, they were landing on sand. And when you land on sand, you land on your, you know, you can twist your knee and you can break your ankle, and if you land awkwardly. And so the authorities of the high jump thought, you know, it's bad that all our people are jumping over bars and hurting themselves. We ought to create a soft landing. So instead of landing on sand, which is soft but not soft enough, we're going to change the landing zone to a cushion. And everybody kept jumping the same way. Everybody did. And it kept going and going. Well, Fosbury made the realization that if you change the landing, why jump the way you were doing before? You can jump with your head first, and you can land on your back and on your head. And that was what change does. And this, to me, is part of it is that it's so simple, and it's such a, you know, no one knows, not most people know about the Fosbury flop, who are familiar with athletic history. They may have been familiar with some of the subtleties of why it works better, but most people aren't familiar with why he changed, and had nothing to do with being smart about making a better jump. It had to do with the change of the environment. It had to do about chaos, the fact that if you change something, it's chaotic. You have an opportunity. And you know, in our world, this was what changed. Many of you probably weren't even alive then, but in June 11th of 2007, this device was released. And the first one looked like this. Had this beautiful black screen, had messaging. We didn't have messaging before. I remember the first time I texted somebody, like, wow, this is super cool. Had a camera in it, had the internet. And lo and behold, a few years later, the world looks like this. Now, it's funny, this is from the Vatican. There's a great picture of the Pope giving the Easter service in 2006, where there are zero cell phones in Vatican City in the square, in St. Peter's Square. And literally 5 years later, it was filled with lights of phones. I've also seen, if you watch, my brother has a photograph of Bruce Springsteen at a concert at Madison Square Garden in 2007, right around when the iPhone came out. And everybody's holding them up in the air, but no one has a cell phone. And then you go 5 years later, everybody has cell phones at concert, taking videos and pictures. Think how the world has changed. Well, in the end, this is our cushion in healthcare. This is our cushion. No one's really taken advantage of this cushion yet. And how do we do that? That's the question. I think that I'm gonna leave this to Greg to talk a little bit about this. But ultimately, we have this massive change in our culture, the way we order things, I ordered a car on the internet this week. You know, everything's changed, but healthcare is lagging. And the reason why healthcare is lagging is for two reasons. One, there's never been money in this. If there's no money, you can't innovate, because you need money to innovate. You're gonna design software and support something, you need to make money. Well, now there is money in this, because suddenly the Klieg lights of healthcare are now on patient experience and things that matter with a patient coming back to the hospital, understanding their medical problem. That's the first thing. The second thing that's changed is the cheapness and the ease of storage and creation and sharing. That's driven by mobile, it's driven by cloud, and it's driven by, you know, ideas now. And so we can be great doctors, and we can have great impact on an individual patient, and we can cure cancer and do things with our hands. But in some ways, these projects can become as meaningful on a much larger scale. And I think that, you know, one of the thing that Netflix did for us, it gave us the opportunity, I've said this before, to have a bigger voice and influence more people. So the last thing I'll say before I let Greg take over the end of this talk is, we welcome you to join us. You know, this is a startup entrepreneurial company that welcomes young, talented, creative people. And because in the old days you used to go into a molecular biology lab or a, you know, gene therapy or something to do research, there's so much opportunity in IT right now for medical research, looking at what works, what doesn't work, you know, whether it's on the administrative side, the patient side, outcomes, quality, you know, patient information. There's so much data in this stuff, data acquisition. There are things like speech and tone and facial recognition to learn when people are sick or when they're stressed. These are all coming. It's a massive amount of technology that's coming our way. And your future, the future leaders of healthcare, are going to be defined as much by their IT knowledge and their understanding of data and AI and all these things as they are in cancer or molecular biology. And so it's not that you shouldn't be interested in the raw science, but if you're looking for a cushion, you're looking for what's changing, and you're looking to see how can I have the greatest impact, these sorts of things are there. I think we're actually maybe even a little bit ahead of our time, but we hope we're Dick Fosbury, and we hope we have that impact in healthcare because of that idea. So Greg, you want to take it from here?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Dave. Why don't you just head one more slide? I think, or this is fine. It's not a big deal. I think what David mentions, you know, when you talk about being an entrepreneur, and I hear this from investors all the time, you know, what they're really interested in is not exactly what your product is, but what problem does it solve? If you want to be successful as an entrepreneur or as a doctor of service to others, the most satisfying aspect of what you can do is to solve problems for other people. That's what makes an enduring, lasting company.
Hey, Greg, I'm gonna interrupt the OR, bud. Okay.
All right. Thanks, Dave.
Thank you for everything. And Randy will be on. You have, you know, at least another 10, 15 minutes. I'm gonna spring Randy from the OR and. Again, thank you for your friendship and everything else.
All right, go save lives.
Yep.
Are you, if you let go of it, I can take over.
I'll leave it. I'll just keep sharing it. You want to take over?
I'll just take over. I have it here.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think everybody can see it. There's not too much stuff there, but you know, we talked a little bit about this last week, and you know, unless people have questions, I can continue to talk about that. Josh, I didn't see the questions. Do you have any?
I can open the chat up right now.
Why don't you open up the chat? I definitely would love to, you know, be able to answer some questions out there. I could talk about this all day, but I think when we talk about, you know, being an entrepreneur, whether it's in medicine or otherwise. And the reason that David and his team are so successful is, one, they invest in others to be successful, and they solve problems for others. And if you get those two tenets, they're probably two of the more important tenets of being a someone for others. And this idea of brain turns is a great example of David and his team of neurosurgeons. What they're giving back to you all is fantastic. I never had this type of stuff growing up, and if I'd had, I would have eaten it up, and I may have stuck with my aspirations of being a doctor. I don't know, but when you think about the importance of mentors and looking up to people and following in others' footsteps and how it's all stokes your own passions of what you want to do. It's pretty incredible. And I applaud everybody that's on here to that that has really focused in on what these people do. Dr. D'Amico, Langer, Ortiz, Bukvar, really just some incredible doctors and what they've accomplished, but they're not doing it for themselves. They're not doing it for their ego. They're all driven by this idea of helping others and being the very best at what they do is what drives them to be better for everyone. And playback is a, you know, it's just one small part of what they do to make themselves better and more of service to other people. So this idea of being able to more clearly communicate with patients and families using technology is, it's not a novel idea in the sense that we've been using Snapchat and WhatsApp and just simple texts and calling and other social media to better communicate with others, to connect with people. You know, what Playback does is just actually bringing those everyday tools into healthcare and allowing doctors the same communication tools that they use every day to communicate with friends and family to be able to communicate with patients and family members of those patients who are now remote at home because of COVID. And it's a very novel idea, but to stand it up in medicine is phenomenally unique. And David had mentioned that we might be before our time, and he may be right, but COVID has brought forward, I would say, at least 2 years, maybe 3 years, the need for these communication tools, because all of a sudden now you have doctors that may be remote from the point of care, nurses, PAs. You certainly have family that's remote from care, that you can only have a one or two family members at the point of care now. In some hospitals, you can't have any. But this idea about using technology now to connect people so that a single update from the doctor notifies everybody on the care team is a pretty fantastic use of technology that up until now really didn't exist. So Playback is unique in the sense that it is technology that's used at the point of care to connect everybody on the care team. And for a patient, you know, there's a lot of people that they want to know what's going on with their care so that they can better communicate that care to other people who are going to be helpful in their recovery. So when they get home, loved ones are going to have to know, how do you clean a wound? How do you dress a wound? What are the medications I need to take? What's the physical therapy that I need to do to get better? And what I mentioned last week, and I strongly believe this, is that whatever it is that you're doing, whether it's recovering from surgery or it's, you know, trying to become a doctor or whatever career that it is that you're going after, you can't do it alone. If you try to do this stuff alone, you will fail. Or you may not fail, but you won't be as satisfied. To bring people along with you on that journey, that experience, to help you be better and for you to help others be better, that's really what is important in this process. And so when you think about what it is that you want to do, it's not the what, it's the who. Who are you going to surround yourself with? What are you going to do outside of your everyday experiences to give you more context, to give you more experience, to give you a greater group of people that you're going to collaborate with? These things are really super important. And I really encourage people to challenge yourself outside of your everyday norms to do something different. You know, whatever it might be, you know, take a cooking class, you know, or learn a language, or take an art class. I remember in 2001, right after I left Wall Street in 2002 for a year and a half. And I went and took an architecture class at Parsons School. And it was an incredible experience. And I met all these new people, new things. I ended up applying to architecture school at one point because I was so intrigued with a different career path. Ultimately, I didn't do that, and then I ended up going back and creating my own trading firm before going to a hedge fund. But you know, it was these new experiences which kind of shaped and changed the way I thought about a career path. And I really encourage everybody to, you know, push yourself beyond what you think your normal everyday is, because it's only going to fortify your experiences and help you have a clearer path to where you want to be. And it will certainly be a heck of a lot more fun to surround yourself with new people that you otherwise would never meet or experience that type of stuff. So like I said, I could go on for any of this for a long period of time. I'm going to stop there, and I can take a couple of questions here for sure. Let's see. Should we future medical professionals come into medicine with knowing about AI and technology? And if new technology came, would we need to know about the technology already? I certainly wouldn't stress about technology. I find that, you know, it's always helpful to have an understanding of what it is, but you'll never master the individual components of what's being achieved, but certainly be aware of it. And I think this comes back to, David will tell you this, is that, you know, David will go to a couple of conferences every year, and the purpose is to meet people, to collaborate with people and see what's out there, and to adapt and to new technology. You certainly have to do, but to adopt certain technologies that you think can make yourself better at what you do, that's really what it's about. It's not the fact that the technology exists and it's cool, but it makes you, it's one of the inputs. We talk about the flywheel. It's one of the inputs that helps you to better attain the goals that you've set forth. And so you need to be really thoughtful about what technology you go after, what's important and what's not important. I spend more time thinking about how certain things are going to help us with playback. And I heard one of these great podcasts. I can't remember who actually did it, but it was this idea of when you're offered opportunity, is it, you know, do you want to do this? Is it a yes out of convenience, or is it a hell yes? Because this is really cool and this is something that's going to help me out or help out our team or our company. And so what you find yourself doing is saying more no to new technology and fewer hell yes, so that when you have a hell yes that you want to get after, you have the time to be able to devote and make it a part of your core inputs to achieving whatever the goals that you set forth. So I would think of like new technology, new AI, if you're reading about it and it gives you a hell yes, you know, include it into your regular regimen. Otherwise, you know, saying no to stuff, it is okay. It allows you more time to focus on the hell yes. Let's see. Do you take any advice from patients when trying to improve your system? Yeah, absolutely. My son actually has a great, he just wrote a bunch of essays for medical school that I'm sure, you know, some of you have already done or some of you will have to do. But one of the things that he's learned, and he's talked about it over and over, is this idea of what he thought patients would want, and designing his biomedical engineering projects around what he thought patients would want. And ultimately, it wasn't what they want. And what he learned instead was that he really had to take the time to fully understand who the patient was, not just their condition, but what their surrounding environment involves and what ultimately their goals were. And truly understanding that requires you to spend time with people, and in this case, patients. So with playback, yes, we spend a lot of time with patients. We have a customer success team where we have families and patients that respond back into the app. Sometimes they're technology questions, sometimes they're clinical questions, But we spend a lot of time in going through those questions, understanding where they're coming from, and learning to apply that back into the technology. So the next person that may have that experience will have the answers from the experience using the technology, or that we can better route those questions back to the point of care so that we can make the experience more satisfying for the people that are using it. So absolutely, you've got to be able to listen to patients. But for you all, you know, this idea of using this technology to better understand providers and patients in the clinical application of technology, highly recommend it. You know, and if people want to have a greater exposure to that environment with playback, feel free to reach out to me. We have plenty of opportunity for people to get involved on how technology affects patient care, how providers use it to communicate and collaborate. So I really encourage people that if you want to spend a little time, you know, we're happy to bring some people on that that can help us focus on it. I can see I went over my time, so I want to turn it over to the doctors and to Josh. I certainly appreciate being back on here again. Thank you, Josh. Thank you, Dr. D'Amico. It's really an honor to be in front of so many smart kids and aspiring kids. I'm just in awe of the opportunity that you present all of these kids and how you all give back to this education process. So